Hey friends, this is Raj again from Christ Words First Ministries from South California. And in my series of videos about the Pauline deception, Paul's deception, which kind of changed the doctrine of Jesus Christ, it's all there in my previous videos. I would encourage you to view them. This one is exclusively dedicated to the conversion story of Apostle Paul mentioned in the Bible, right? We're going to examine what really happened at the conversion of Paul from Saul the brutal, murderous Pharisee who blasphemed God by his own admission and submission. He was a blasphemer of God, and he made others blaspheme also the new Christians who had come to Christ, you know. He was a brutal persecutor, so brutal that they had fled. Many of them fled to Damascus from Israel. Now, this man did not give up. He and his lynch mob members went to Damascus, or tried to go to Damascus to get them back. He was a very vicious persecutor. Now, and then he of course changed, or claimed to have changed, after a vision of Christ. That's what we're going to examine through this video today, friends. What really happened? Because this is vital, crucial, since it is Paul who changed the doctrine of salvation from faith, baptism, and obedience of what Jesus taught to doctrine of saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, what is now known as the sola fide doctrine, which is nothing but deception. And we'll come to know how. I mentioned that in my previous videos. I would highly encourage you. I'll be planting some link on this. I encourage you to go through that. But this is dedicated exclusively to what happened at the time of Saul's conversion, that he became Paul. So the story starts, brothers and sisters, in Acts 9, 1 and 2. In Acts 9 and goes on. So let's start that, reading that. So it's Acts 9. Starting from one, but Saul, still breathing murderous threats against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and begged him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he should find there any followers of the way, they called Christ Christian way, Christianity the way, Jesus the way. So that if they should find there any followers of the way of Jesus Christ, whether men or women, Paul could bring them back to Jerusalem as prisoners. So he wasn't satisfied with brutally and murderously persecuting them in Jerusalem. Now he chased them, these poor, actually very poor people, helpless, to Damascus. And while he was on the way, everything happened. That's in Acts 9, 3 and 4. But on the journey, as Paul neared Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly blazed around him and he fell to the ground. Then he heard a voice speaking to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Saul says, "Who are you, Lord?" he asked. The voice says, "I am Jesus who you are persecuting." That was the reply. "But now stand up and go into the city. There you will be told what you must do." His companions on the journey stood there speechless, for they had heard the voice but could not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. He had turned blind. Or he claimed he did. So they took him by the hand and led him into Damascus. There he remained sightless for 3 days. And during that time, he had nothing to eat or drink. Alright. So this is how the conversion story goes. And then 9 verse 10. Now in Damascus, there was a disciple by the name of Ananias. द लॉर्ड स्पोक टू दिस मैन इन अ ड्रीम कॉलिंग हिम बाय हिज नेम गॉड सेज आई मीन द लॉर्ड जीसस आई एम हियर लॉर्ड ही रिप When Jesus called him by his name, Ananias replied, I am here, Lord, he replied. Then Lord said to him, Get up and go down to the street called Straight and inquire at the house of Judas for a man named Saul from Tarsus. At this moment he is praying in the house of Judas. And he sees in his mind's eye a man by the name of Ananias coming to the house and placing his hands upon him, Paul, to restore his sight. But Ananias replied, Lord, I have heard on all hands about this man and how much harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. Why, even now he holds power from the chief priests to arrest all those who call upon your name. But the Lord said to him, Go on your way, for this man is my chosen instrument to bear my name before the Gentiles and their kings, as well as to the sons of Israel. Indeed, I myself show him what he must suffer for the sake of my name. Then Ananias set out and went to the house, and there he laid his hands upon Saul and said, Saul, brother, the Lord has sent me, Jesus, who appeared to you on the journey here, so that you may recover your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. 9:18-19, immediately something like scales fell up from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got to his feet and was baptized. Then he took some food and regained his strength. So friends, on the face of it, as they say, prima facie, it all looks genuine that this guy, the brutal persecutor of Christian church, now has a change of heart. He's accosted by Jesus, as he claims, and then Jesus convinces him that, why do you persecute? Now you will be told what to do, and this brutal persecutor doesn't argue at all, nothing. Maybe he was blown over by the supernatural appearance of Christ and he proceeds to Damascus. And now he's waiting for a man called, he's there praying in the house of Judas. Now, there are some hidden, like I said, prima facie, or however you pronounce, on the face of it appears all good. It's when you start digging into the story that a lot of filth comes out, filth of deception. Let us see, and inconsistencies, I'll be reading out one by one. Have patience, friends. This is very important. If you love Jesus, you must understand or must know who did this doctrine emanate from. All that Paul taught, especially doctrine of grace. Jesus never had used the word grace in his entire ministry, before crucifixion, after crucifixion, or in future times in Revelation. Grace is conspicuous by its absence in the teachings of Christ. So let us be careful when we examine and before we accept the story which Paul gave to us of his conversion. Because remember, it's a one-sided story. There is no way to ascertain whether this man was lying or he was telling the truth. And that is why the story was made of a vision. Because he had no credible witnesses. We just read the mob, which, or the companions of Paul who saw the conversion, were lynch mob people who were brutally, murderously persecuting Christians, the new Christians who were turning to Jesus. These were the same lynch mob members who were Paul's companions, who saw the conversion happen. Alright? So there were no credible witnesses. I will not accept them as a credible witness. will you? These lynch mob murderers, whether that happened or not. Now, so since we have only an account of somebody claiming to have seen a vision, let us play a bit of Sherlock Holmes. Let us dig deeper. What really happened? Well, the Bible gives us the scoop. It tells us what happened. Let us start with inconsistencies in the accounts. All right? This is from the Bible. I'm not trying to prejudice you. It is there. I'm convinced this man is a fake. I've mentioned that 100 times. But let us see, what does the Bible say? What evidence does the Bible provide? What does it record for us? That we understand that this, we are playing again the sleuth Sherlock Holmes and examining the evidence we have at hand. According to Acts 9, verse 3 and 8, Paul was blinded by the light and fell down. But his men did not see the light, but heard the voice of Jesus. They remained standing, okay? But they had heard the voice. They were standing, but they did not see the light, but they heard the voice, okay? That's provided for us in Acts 9, 3 to 8. What does Acts 22, 6, 11 tell us? Paul told the people, now here's the inconsistency number one. Paul told the people he was blinded by a light and fell down. Again, he said the same thing. But this time, his men saw the light. Remember, in Acts 9:3-8, they did not see the light. But now, Paul is saying they saw the light. Alright? But unlike Paul, they were not blinded. And they did not hear the voice. They were blinded by the light and they did not see the light but heard the voice. But the next time in Acts 22:6-11, they say they saw the light, but they did not hear the voice which they had heard. What do you make of that? Inconsistency has cropped up here. To add to that inconsistency, in Acts 26:13-19, Paul tells King Agrippa, who was trying him, that he saw a brilliant light and heard Jesus, who gave him his mission, but did not command him to go to Damascus, which he does in the first two versions in Acts, that Jesus commanded him to go to Damascus. But to Agrippa, he doesn't say that. Then Paul says he fell down, but there is no mention of blindness. He forgets to tell Agrippa that he had become blind. Nor is there any mention of the men seeing or hearing anything. Although for some reason his men also fell down. This is what he told Agrippa, that they fell down, which they hadn't in the first two accounts. He told those at Damascus in Jerusalem about his conversion experience. So this is a change in accounts happening here. Why did Paul change his accounts in these three verses, which I just spelled out, read out rather? Who changes accounts, friends? You must have watched court TVs and those televisions which record and recreate crime scenes. And actually sometimes they show accused criminals recording confessions or their statements, typically statements. But oftentimes those who are lying, they change their statements. Maybe they don't remember. Maybe they are scared that this may work, this may not work, so let's go to a second, maybe a better. A truthful person does not change their account, friends, because the truth is one. Whatever happened, you narrate. Like for example, Jack was hit by a bus. Jack sees the bus, steps on the side, and yet the bus hurts him and goes away. Jack remembers and he tells the truth. There is nothing to create. This is what happened. And Jack, or you and me, will just an analogy, a crude analogy. If there is a truthful event, there is nothing that needs to be changed. You just keep repeating what happened. You're not fearful because you have done nothing. You're the victim. In this case, there was a change. Accounts were being changed. My question is, why? All right? That's one thing we have to... Like I said, we are playing the sleuth. We are playing Sherlock Holmes. We're trying to understand. Remember, the same vision this guy, what Paul claims he saw, 300 years down the road, a man called Constantine, who... There are a lot of allegations against this man. He was a Roman emperor. He had a hand in the selection of the books of Bible, in the canonizing of Bible. This man, Constantine, also got a vision similar to Paul. And he says God, doesn't say Jesus, spoke to him. Think about all these friends. What is going on? He also got a vision. Like I said before, no, there is no way to ascertain. There is no proof one way or the other a person has seen or not. Like Paul has no credible witnesses except for murderers standing with him, who sometimes stand, sometimes fall, sometimes see, sometimes do not see, with changing accounts. Alright? Absorb all these friends. Then we'll go further. Now this part is over. Paul claims he saw Jesus, who changed his mind, and he proceeded to Damascus. Paul, okay? I'll be reading out Acts 9, 10 to 19, alright? This is the second part of what I call the Great Deception. It was in two parts. Now in Damascus, there was a disciple by the name of Ananias. All right. The Lord spoke to this man in a dream. That's what he claims. Calling him Ananias by his name. He said, Ananias, I'm here. Ananias. And Ananias replied, I'm here, Lord. He replied. 9:11-12. Then the Lord said to him, get up and go down to the street called Straight and inquire of the house of Judas for a man named Saul from Tarsus. At this moment, Saul is praying in the house of Judas, and he sees in his mind's eye a man by the name of Ananias coming into the house and placing his hands upon him, that is Saul, to restore his sight. But Ananias replied to Jesus, Lord, I have heard of on all hands about this man and how much harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. Why, even now he holds powers from the chief priests to arrest all who call upon your name. So obviously Ananias knew about Paul and what was going on. Acts 9:15-16. But the Lord said to him, go on your way, Ananias, for this man, Paul or Saul, is my chosen instrument to bear my name before the Gentiles and their kings, as well as to the sons of Israel, both Jews and Gentiles. Indeed, I myself will show him what he must suffer for the sake of my name. Then Ananias set out, was convinced, okay, that is Jesus who appeared to him in his dream this time, not a vision, a dream occurred. Then Ananias set out and went to the house of Judas. And there he laid his hands upon Saul and said, Saul, brother, the Lord has sent me, Jesus who appeared to you on your journey there, so that you may recover your sight and may be filled with the Holy Spirit. 9:18-19 Acts. Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got to his feet and was baptized. Then he took some food and regained his strength. there were changing accounts in the first part. Let us examine, friends, diligently what happened subsequently after the conversion took place. He went to Damascus. Where in Damascus? To one house of Judas. Waiting there, praying. As if he knew he had to wait for somebody. And he was waiting. Meanwhile, Jesus appears to a man called Ananias. All right? And he tells Ananias that, Ananias, go to this guy. He's my chosen instrument to share my name. He has appointed Paul the 13th apostle now. 12 are already in action who have no clue, nothing, that this is happening. His beloved apostles were kept in the dark by Jesus Christ himself, if Paul was speaking the truth, and this Ananias, then they were there. The 12 apostles, of handpicked apostles of Christ, were kept in the dark about this discreet development, a prime development from the point of view of Christian faith. Because this man, Paul, would become the greatest apostle of Jesus, best known apostle at least of Jesus Christ. So remember that, friends. The apostles of Christ have no clue, nothing, that this is happening. All right? So we're trying to play the sleuth here, trying to understand, absorb what happened. A lot of filth will come out, as we see. Now, this whole thing can be divided into two parts. Paul gets a vision, gets converted. That's not enough. For Christians to believe, there has to be somebody who will now take him to assure him into Christian faith. Ananias, I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, is the man who now will take this converted murderer, Paul, to Christians and the disciples in some way. I got a dream from the Lord. I helped this man. He was lending credence to Paul's story. So therefore, this man is crucial, needs to be examined. Who? Ananias. And I did that. I'm sharing this after 4 or 5 years of due diligence on Paul. What really happened? That the whole doctrine of God was changed from faith, baptism, obedience to just believe and you go to heaven by this Saul, the Pharisee. Let us examine then who is this Ananias, right? Since he is such a crucial figure in the whole conversion story, we have to examine who this man is. My due diligence led me to these conclusions or these facts. According to Acts 9:10, Ananias was living in Damascus. Right? In Paul's speech in Acts 22, Paul describes Ananias as a devout man according to the law, having a good report with all report of all of the Jews. So Paul is basically describing Ananias as a devout man according to the law, having a good report of all the Jews that lived in Damascus. This is Acts 22 verse 12. And according to researchers, this indicates that he was not one of the refugees from the persecution in Jerusalem described in Acts 8 verse 1. Ananias was not a refugee. He was one of the Jews who lived in Damascus. Right? And he is a crucial man, a key man who's lending credence to Paul's story. However, we must keep this in mind. If we are arguing in the court as a prosecution against Paul, we must keep this in mind that this man was not a refugee from the persecution, but a devout Jew. Did you know, guys, this Ananias is a mysterious figure in Bible, alright? Apart from Paul, there is nobody who gave him any kind of reference. My question to you is, suppose there are two people, Jerry, and let's say there is another called Robin, or friends, this Ananias who got the good report from Paul did not get a good report or anti-report, whichever, from anybody else. He got his good report only from Paul. Now Paul is under the microscope. He is the one who is being questioned here in this episode. So he is the only person who's giving a report for Ananias. Who from the Christian church knows this man? Does Peter know? Does John know? Matthew? Does anybody else know except Paul? Now Paul is in the limelight. He's on the spotlight. He's being tried here by us. This man was lying. We are trying that. Now think of Jerry and his friend. I said Robin. Let's say Robin is a girl's name. Let's say Jerry and Alan are two friends. All right. They commit a heist together. And Jerry, when caught by the police, claims that he's innocent and that his innocence can be proved by Alan, who's his accomplice in the heist. Police doesn't know. But this guy Jerry has no other friend, so he points at his accomplice. What does the accomplice Alan say? Yeah, he was with me. Well, he won't say at the heist, but in my house, let's say. So this guy's alibi is coming from another rogue, another culprit. I'm not saying without proof. Ananias disappeared from the scene. Ananias, the man who claims he went to the house of Judas, where he saw Saul the Pharisee, the brutal murderer Pharisee, sitting, how dark that scene must be, and praying in the house of one Judas. He goes there and he puts his hand on Saul the Pharisee and something like scales fell from this snake's eyes. Saul's eyes. I did say it on purpose. So the only man who witnessed the scales and the story that he was sitting in the house of Judas praying, and then Ananias, to whom Jesus appeared in his dream and tells him, goes to the house of Judas. And there you will see Saul from Tarsus, and you will bless him, you know, kind of, which he did, and by his own submission. All this is now The story is revolving around two people, Saul the Pharisee and his friend, or a man called Ananias from Damascus. Nobody knows about him except for Paul. Nobody knows about this man. Did he take part, any further part in Saul's missions or anything? Or was his sole job to say that he got a vision or a dream and he went and he took the he baptized Paul, and now Paul is ready. All right, so who's this mysterious man Ananias? That's my question, bottom line, because all this seems very dark to me, you know. Suspicious, sneaky. Who's this man? Again, everybody's claiming. Somebody's claiming vision. Somebody's claiming I got a dream. Where are the real people? Where are the real Christians? Not one is there now. The lynch mob murderers saw him getting converted. This man is a Jew living in Damascus who's testifying for this man, Saul the brutal Pharisee, that he saw him sitting in the house of Judas and that he saw a dream. Where are the Christians, the one who believed Jesus? Where are they? Why aren't they in the picture? Why didn't Jesus use any of them? So that we, the readers, may know, or we identify with Peter, with let's say Matthew, with Thomas, with others like John. Where are they? Why couldn't Jesus use them? John, go. There's this 13th apostle I have appointed. He's going to bear my name and be my witness. He's going to join your gang. When you have a top brass 12 apostles, won't you tell them, friends, when Christ Jesus is appointing a 13th, look guys, one is coming and joining your ranks and file. Accept him. He's my man. He was a previous brutal persecutor, but I've changed his mind. Now he's going to join you. Go receive him. Nothing. Christ says nothing about this man. Alright? Instead, he chooses to catch hold of a Jew. Some of these Jews had murdered Jesus on the cross. Remember, they had rejected Jesus Christ's doctrine. Many of them. I'm not saying all. And this guy, as the research points out, Ananias was a Jew, according to a devout Jew, and who disappears from the scene once Paul comes in, or at least Bible does not ever mention him afterwards. Do you find all this suspicious, friends? I do. We don't have a credible witness yet. That's what is bothering me. It is pricking me hard. Why aren't there credible witnesses either in his conversion and now in his scales of his eyes falling? Who has witnessed all this apart from this guy whose Paul is giving the report? Like I said, Jerry and his friend Alan are pointing to each other, but we don't have a credible witness yet. These two have done a heist, let's say Alan and Jerry, and they're relying on each other's support. This is exactly what is happening. This second man, Ananias, is mixed with this man, Paul, Saul the Pharisee. Who's their boss? Who's pulling the strings? Devil. See, this is what happened at the time of death of Jesus on the cross. The sin penalty of sin was paid by Christ for those who were willing to obey him. He says that. I've mentioned all that in 100 times in my previous videos. I will request you to go through it. This one is dedicated only to the conversion of Paul. Don't want to digress. When devil lost on the cross, it's mentioned, right? What did he do? Did he sit quietly? I've lost. My kingdom is gone. And now these guys, Paul and all, tried to contain the church growth, which did not, he could not stem the growth. it grew exponentially. And then the conversion happened. No, conversion did not happen. Deception happened. Devil appointed two people. And they were working as a team, unknown to the innocent, poor Christians like us. We didn't know what is happening. We just took his words for granted. Based on this sleuth work, this detective work, playing Sherlock Holmes, we can see that these guys don't have a genuine witness. There is no credible witnesses in the conversion or subsequent to that in Damascus. I'll keep giving you more proof, brothers and sisters. So they're pointing at each other. Long story short, Saul and Ananias. Ananias also does not have any kind of credible witness that this guy, he has worked for the Lord Jesus even after Paul. No, nothing. Nobody knows anything about him except Paul's own report. Only Paul gives a report about Ananias, and Ananias says, I saw this guy sitting in the house of Judas praying and scales fell. We want genuine witness. Oh, I'm not believing this nonsense going on, this very dark episodes, which finally led to what? Paul being included as another apostle, the 13th apostle. Now here are the proof after proof that this man is a fake. Jesus says in Revelation 2 verse 2, he commends the church of Ephesus for exposing false apostles. Who's this false apostle he's talking about? 12, including Matthias, are already apostles. This one is the 13th apostle, the unlucky 13th. Who out of these 13th was exposed? It's happening now. As you see this video, he's getting exposed now after 2000 years of deception. Jesus was commending our church, us Christians, for catching this man. Again, if you don't want to believe that, go to Revelation 21 verse 14. On the last day, when the last day would mean subsequent to the last day, when the new Jerusalem comes down, the new heaven, it had 12 names of only 12 names of the Lamb's apostles. One was missing, conspicuous by its absence. Who was this 13th apostle who was rejected? Now there are 13, right? Matthias was selected by Christ Jesus' spirit himself. 11 were there, 12 are already standing, and then this man claims he saw this vision and XYZ, blah, 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 and he became the 13th apostle. Amongst these 13, one was rejected. I leave it to you to understand or to make a guess or an assumption or a conclusion. Who was not honored by Christ Jesus on the last day? Why didn't Jesus mention by his words, I'll be sending an apostle? Nothing. Seems he got scared of this brutal Pharisee, the way he narrated the tale, that the way he was persecuting, that he changed his mind and made him work for him, but doesn't tell anything to his own apostles, Jesus Christ, right? So these things have to be kept into account. All these things happened at the time of conversion story, which was made complete with Ananias. There were two people devil had hired. One was this brutal murderer slash Pharisee Saul, the brutal persecutor of the church. One, he, the natural enemy of Christ as devil. These two joined hands. And then there was Ananias, the second guy, because devil knew on his own Saul wouldn't make it. There had to be another guy who came, played a part, and vanished from the scene. Where is Ananias in Bible after that day? Gone, finished, disappeared, did his job, and ran away, right? See, guys, finally, I'll end with this. I'll leave it to you to understand what happened. Finally, see, Jesus says that Jesus says in Matthew 11:19 that wisdom is proved right by its actions / results. What it means is proof of pudding lies in its taste, right? Otherwise you can brag all you like, but it it's in the taste lies the proof of the pudding. What did this man Paul teach? Grace, saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, the sola fide doctrine. Like I said before, Jesus never uttered the word grace. Did Jesus Christ forget? Ministering to millions of people, teaching them. He was, they used to call him rabbi, teacher. He was very, very loving and passionate teacher who kept teaching even on the cross. When he was brutally done to death on the cross, what did he teach us? The message of forgiveness. Forgive, Lord, for they do not know, Father. They do not know what they do. Even on the cross, Jesus was teaching. He was that teacher till the end. What happened when he got resurrected? He taught again. Matthew 28, 18, 20 is a great example. The Great Commission was given subsequent to his death on the cross when he got resurrected. What did he teach in Matthew 28, 18, 20? Make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey, observe all things I have commanded. And truly I shall be with you till the end of the ages. So this guy, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, why didn't he mention grace, the vital ingredient in Paul's doctrine of salvation? Is saved by grace through faith, Ephesians 2:8-9, and not by works, not through obedience or works, lest no man may boast. Why didn't Jesus teach grace, friends? Why isn't it mentioned anywhere in the four Gospels? Did he forget? Begs that question. Did he forget to teach grace? Oh my gosh, I've forgotten to teach grace after, let's say, he ascended heaven. I've forgotten to teach the most vital ingredient of salvation is grace. And now I've forgotten to teach grace, saved by grace alone, through faith alone. Let me appoint another apostle, 13th one. Can this happen? It cannot. He's the face of God, the perfect God. He didn't miss out anything. This was all added by Paul. He twisted the whole doctrine. Why did he twist? So that we may not obey. It's not needed, friends. This is what you must have been taught at the churches. I also. Why did Paul keep teaching can't be saved by through obedience or good works, when Jesus himself says all those trees which do not bear good fruit will be chopped and thrown into fire? Or his brother James says in James 2:20, which directly contradicts the whole doctrine of Paul. He says, you fool, don't you know faith is dead without good works? And again, here comes the final proof, the damning evidence against this man, Saul, that his doctrine fell flat on its face on the last day. That's in Matthew 25:31-46, where Jesus already gave us the vision of future day judgment. It's a vision, not a parable. And the vision states that Jesus is going to come down as the judge, and he will judge all nations, every person, Christian or otherwise, dividing us individually for what we had done, not what we had believed. Good Samaritan had no faith in Jesus. He had lifted him up. I'm going to break this so-called Apostle Paul's teaching doctrine now into pieces. Why didn't Jesus on the last day, according to Matthew 25:31-46, Jesus used only one metric to save or condemn, and that was acts of loving compassion. That's it. Something which Paul never taught. Neither did he teach us to do the will of God, without which we cannot be saved, says Jesus Christ in Matthew 7:21, Mark 3:35, and some other places as well. Jesus is very clear. unless you do the will of God, guys, you're not going to make it. And what was the will of God? He proves that in the on the last day, Matthew 25, 31 to 46, which is sheep and the goats parable, or vision rather, where he says he'll use the acts of loving compassion. Whoever had them, whoever unconditionally got out of their self-absorption and helped others, even strangers, with kind acts, they are the ones who he will lift up, not believers. Goats were believers. Read that. I'm not saying it. Jesus is saying, Matthew 25, 31 to 46. Goats believed, but they didn't have works of loving compassion. Paul never taught us works. We are sitting secure in our salvation. Jesus says, whoever loves their life will lose it. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Did you know all these verses, friends? I'm trying to keep this short. In other words, on the last day, faith will not be used, or faith alone cannot be used. Because Jesus says the universe can disappear. My words simply cannot go. This event will happen. We will be divided amongst goat and sheep. And this vision theory of Paul, which led to him becoming an apostle by his own claims, and his doctrine came to be believed, especially past 500 years, by Protestant churches especially, where you are saved by faith alone. This has come crashing down on the final day, rejected in toto, in totality, by none other than Christ himself, which you should have known. Because Jesus always pointed at love. Why? Because he is love. Where does that say? 1 John 4 verse 8. God is love. And whoever does not learn to love does not know God. God is love. He repeats that in 1 John 4 verse 16. God is love. What does John 10:30 say? Christ and God are one. What does that make Jesus? Love. What did he come to teach? Love. Where does it say that? It's beyond the scope of all this. I'm quickly trying to say, go to 5 verses 22, sorry, Matthew 22, 37 to 40. Love God with all your heart, mind and soul. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do to others as you would want them to do to you. Matthew 7, 12. And he says that when you do that, you obey the entire law and teachings of the prophets. In nutshell, in one line, Jesus says doctrine revolved around love and doing the will of God, which is love. This Paul never taught. He kept harping on grace, 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 which Jesus didn't talk about. So now you know the whole story, the conversion. I leave it to you. You want to believe this man or his sidekick, Ananias, who disappears from the scene? I leave it to your judgment, friends. Thank you for listening to this. If you want to share, if you are convicted, share it. I just work because I love the Lord. I don't take a penny, no donations accepted, nothing. I love the Lord and I will share. I'm his German shepherd. I ask questions and I'm his watchdog. I will ask questions. If this doesn't fit into the large picture, then I will say, I'll voice my protest. So friends, with this, I conclude. And God bless you all. Thank you very much.